Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, for those of us that, Lord Christ, our Savior, Lord, help us to grow in our relationship with you here today, with our relationship with one another. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day. We've come out to worship. Lord, we pray that you be lifted up and glorified in everything we say and everything we do. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. So glad to have each and every one of you here today. I was up here, I was looking over the congregation, I was singing, and I said, man, it must be vacation season. You're opening deer season, all these empty pews. So where is everybody? And then I turned around and looked at the choir. They're all up here. I don't know if we can move this choir loft anymore, Brother Josh. I think, I don't know, start kicking some out. I don't know. Just teasing. We still have room for more. We sure would love to have a bigger choir serving, singing praises unto our God. So we're so glad you're here today. And we just want to thank God for his goodness as we get into God's word. I'm going to have Pastor Josh come back up. He's going to lead the choir as we continue the services this morning. Brother Josh.
From the trials that it seemed I faced alone, wondering why God left me here to struggle on my own. I thought of all the verses and the scriptures I had read, how he promised to be with me, how he never would forsake me.
You were there for me. Thank you, choir, for that good song. We have been working on that one for a long, long time. I hope it was a blessing. Let's stand together once more and sing song number 26. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Song number 26 as we all stand together.
God's word. Let's open our Bibles up to Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4, to catch up, we started last week, we looked at the parable of the sower, and the interesting point, or interesting tidbit of this passage of scripture as we read it, is that Jesus was so popular at this time, there were so many people, that he actually, Mark chapter 4 all takes place on the deck of a ship. And Jesus anchored the shore, and he's on the deck of the ship, and he's talking to everybody, and then, well, he decides he's done, and he goes to take a nap in the boat and says, hey, just go over to the other side, and then we are told, we know the story, a storm comes on. Now, Mark tells us, that's why we're in Mark's account here, that Mark tells us that Jesus' boat was not the only boat caught up in the storm. We'll begin our reading in Mark chapter 4 in verse 30, and we'll read down through the rest of the chapter. We're in Mark chapter 4 in verse 30, the word of God says, and he said, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or to what comparison shall we compare it? is a grain of mustard seed, which, when it is sown into the earth, is less than all the seeds that be in the earth. But when it is sown, it groweth up and becometh greater than all herbs, and shooteth out great branches, so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. With many such parables spake he the word unto them, as they were able to hear it. But without a parable spake he not unto them. And when they were alone, he expounded all things to his disciples. And the same day, when the evening was come, he said unto them, Let's pass over to the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of the wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he that was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep in the pillow, and they awake him, and they say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said unto them, Why are ye so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly, and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray today that you'd help us to learn something from your word here today that will strengthen us. Lord, get me out of the way, hide me behind the cross, that, Lord, somebody who may need to hear the gospel today may get saved. Lord, I pray for Christians here today that, Lord, you'd strengthen us by your word. Help us to grow here today. Let there be no distractions that would stop what you'd have us to do. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Let us this morning consider the little ships just for a moment. The little ships caught out in the storm with Jesus. It is easy as we read this passage to get caught up in the marvel of this amazing story. And in fact, this is covered in all the Gospels except for John. But Mark is the only one that tells us that there were also little ships with him. Now, we could read through this and we could say this is useless background info. Mark is just more vivid. He's painting us a picture. So in our mind's eye, when we consider the storm, when we see the waves on Jesus' boat, we can also picture little boats all around him going through the same thing. But I'm telling you, they may seem insignificant details of the scripture, but if we could talk to those in those little boats, they wouldn't think so, would they? They would say, good night, we're caught in a storm too. We're taking on water. We're going to sink. This is absolutely terrible. And I can tell you this, since the Bible has it in there, we know it's in there for a reason. And we also know that God cares about those people. Now, I truly hope that Jesus is in your boat this morning. What do I mean by that? I hope that you've trusted him as your Lord and Savior. I hope there's no doubt in your mind this morning that you have a place, a time where you remember, where you ask Jesus in your heart, you believe on his death, burial, and resurrection. Know you all him, all right? And you, well, I'm heaven bound, I'm saved. Everywhere I go, Jesus is in my boat with me. I hope so. And if not, boy, you could fix that today. And it would be the best day of your life. But beyond that, let me tell you this, the storm is raging. But you know what? Storms are a little disconcerting, they are, but it's not so bad when you got Jesus in your boat, is it? You rest safely. Now listen, this is very important. Every one of us with Jesus in our boat, do you realize we have little boats all around us? Little boats without Jesus in them? Do you realize that? And they may seem insignificant people in our life. I hate to say that. I hate the idea of thinking there's insignificant people in my life, in your life, but really we see these people as trivial relationships. They're background people. So maybe it's the cashier at the store that you see maybe once a week, maybe a little bit more than that. And, you know, when they disappear, you say, hey, what happened to so-and-so? Oh, they transferred, they moved or whatever. And you go, oh, okay, that's cool, that's cool. Maybe it's a neighbor. I don't know how you are with your neighbors. Out here in White Lake, people tend to be, I mean, our borders are kind of close. So everybody either hates their neighbor or loves their neighbor, and there's no in between, right? But if you live on a lake, you do not like your neighbor. I've learned that the hard way, okay? I don't live on a lake myself, but, you know, in property lines, they got to, you know. But maybe you got a neighbor that's, you know, maybe two doors down, and you drive by them, and when they're mowing their lawn, you do the old neighbor wave, right? You know? Maybe it's that, and you're like, I don't know. You just make up a name. That guy's name is Frank. I have no idea what the guy's name is, you know, or maybe it is, but, you know, here's the thing, though. We got to understand that we have little ships in our life, and we probably have a bigger impact in their life than we think we do sometimes. I believe there's little ships probably in this auditorium here this morning. I know there's little ships downstairs in the children's program. There's little ships. I want to take a look, because I think these little ships are important. And I want to take a look just for a moment at these little ships. And the first point I'd like to bring out of the scripture here is these little ships are weathering the same storm as us, but they don't have Jesus in their boat. The same wind, the same waves, the same struggle to stay afloat. Again, I want to draw your attention to verse 37. And there arose a great storm. The Bible says it's a great storm. I believe it's a great storm. And he says, and the waves beat on the ship so that it was now full. Rain is not filling up the boat. The waves are so big that they're breaking over the bow of the ship and they're now filling up the boat. Now, I've done enough kayaking, okay? I did pass boater safety in seventh grade. I don't remember much from then. But I do kayak. I know that once you get water in your boat, it's not a good thing. Normally, you want to bail it out. You want to get it out. You start riding lower in the water. You're slower. You start to kind of, because the water, as the boat kind of goes back and forth in the waves, the water will go that way also, and it kind of make you list a little bit more one way or the other. It's a very dangerous situation. Of course, the men in the boat, these disciples being fishermen, they're probably quite aware of this also. You know, and we've just been reminded this last week, we've been praying for those caught up in Florida and the storm that's come through. The Hurricane Ian, I mean, that some of the pictures are terrifying. Somebody was showing me pictures and said, look at the water's gone, the ocean's gone in this area. Well, we know where it's at. We've seen those videos too. They're in other places. They're flooding people's houses, or they're retreating up into their attics and then finding they have no way out once they're in there, and they're air rescuing people like crazy. We're seeing houses and boats just turned upside down and cars everywhere. The storm is absolutely bad. Well, you know, that's a storm. And we all know storms. We can track them. They come, they go. We have apps for that. We got to understand, you know, we have other kind of storms too. In the last couple of years, we've been in the midst of a worldwide pandemic. We've been watching the news for wars and rumors of wars. You know, I get concerned when nuclear powers start getting desperate. We've seen economic devastation. You know, we have a family of five. It's a lot to feed them now. I know I can't be the only one taking on water, right? The storms are coming. They're here. You know those little ships, gas costs them $4 a gallon too. I heard in the news, Brother Josh, you might want to sit down for this. They were thinking about raising the price of a Costco hot dog and drink. Then you know the economy's bad. But luckily it was just a rumor. It was just a rumor. They're not going to do it. You're okay. Hey, those little ships are scared. Those little ships are scared. By the way, so were the disciples. We understand these little ships go through the same storm as us, but they don't have Jesus in their boat. The little ships don't have Jesus to wake up. I don't know what your relationship is like Jesus this morning. I don't know if you're my sons. The first thing that happens, they fall down, they hurt themselves, we drive by an accident. Their first thing to do is they pray. Man, I wish I was like that. Sometimes my last thing I think of to do is pray. After I've done everything else I can possibly do is pray. And the disciples were kind of like that. Let's bail out the water. Let's get to shore. Let's do all this. And once they realize we're going down with the ship, disciples, they said, okay, now let's go wake up Jesus. Maybe you have that type of relationship, but hey, at least you have Jesus to wake up in your life. At least you have an altar to kneel on and say, I'm drowning. There's a storm. I'm scared. I don't know what to do. Jesus, I need you. But boy, there's little boats. Once the water starts to break over their ship and they start taking it on, and it starts riding lower and lower in the water, they don't have that. They just have to go, well, this is it. No hope and no peace. I believe there's people like that in our communities all around us right now. There's little ships right now. They have no hope and they have no peace in the storm. When Jesus is in your boat, no matter how bad it gets, you can always call upon him. Can I share with you just for a moment, Psalm 50 and verse 15, it should be on the screen here behind me. Word of God says, and call upon me in the day of trouble, and I'll answer thee, and thou shalt glorify me. Psalm 86, verse 7, in the day of trouble I will call upon thee, for thou wilt answer me. Jeremiah 33, 3, call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Hey, when the storm comes, it's good to have Jesus in your boat. Boy, what an understatement, huh? I am really underselling it this morning. Imagine for a moment, friends, what would it be like living in 2020 in your life right now without a relationship with Lord Jesus Christ? I got to tell you, that's, you know, I know sometimes we kind of poke fun at lost people, the delusions they come up with, but I mean, what else do they have? Man, we got Jesus in our boat, friends. And can I tell you, it's so much more dangerous for them. I believe the Bible says they're little ships. They're probably littler than Jesus' ship. Jesus is actually in a part away from the storm sleeping, and he's not being woke up, okay? He sleeps like my children, I guess, on a Sunday morning, you know? He's hard to wake up, okay? But can I tell you, these little boats are probably just little rowboats out there. The waves are beating on them more. They're in a worse situation. By the way, when you're scared and desperate and you lose hope, that's when you make dumb life decisions. It's scary out there. And you know what? The storm gets us. Let's just say the worst thing in the world happens to us. I don't know. Our worst day, we wake up and we get to see the face of our Savior, Jesus Christ, and live in mansions of glory for all eternity. Amen. We get to praise our God, you know? If the storm really does take us under, if we really do, and it's our time, it's going to be the best moment of our life. We get to see heaven's glory, our past loved ones, and no night, just in the light of our God. You know, for the lost, without Jesus in their boat, and they sink, the storm was the least of their concerns. They're going to be suffering for eternity. It's way more dangerous. In the storms of life, Jesus makes the difference. Make sure Jesus is in your boat. I hope this morning you've trusted Christ, your Savior. If you have any question in your heart at all, talk to myself or Pastor Josh or any of our deacons or deacons' wives, our wives. Please, it's so important that you know in this day and age you have Jesus in your boat. But let's make sure that we have a heart for the little boats in our life. Let's consider them just for a moment. We talked about the little boats are without Jesus. They're weathering the same storm. Secondly, I'd like to point out to you that they're watching the boat with Jesus in it. These boats are there, and look at verse 36. They tell us about them. It says, there were also with him other little boats. These boats are not just on the water, they're with him. I imagine the multitude, some of them said, we're not going away. Some of them said, hey, we're going to hang out. This guy's doing miracles. He's doing bread. This is incredible. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to stay with him. And they get their boat, and they're right there with Jesus, and they want to be with him. And I can only imagine, they're all looking, which boat was Jesus on? It was that one. Yep, that's the one. Now, they don't see him, okay? He's sleeping. Jesus is sleeping below deck. They don't see him. They only see the disciples. They know that's the boat with Jesus. And I can't help but pull a parallel today. I believe in the storms of our neighbors, our cashiers, those little boats, they're kind of looking at us because they know we have Jesus in our boat. They can't see Jesus, but they can see us, can't they? And they're watching us to see what we're going to do today. They're watching us to see, well, okay, let's see, you know, I know that the economy and recession and inflation and I know the rumors of wars, I know pandemic, and they're just kind of watching us. They're watching you because they want to see. These little boats would like to look to the boat where they've seen the miracles. And let me present you with two different scenarios. Let's do this, okay? The first scenario is these disciples are, the storm's busting over the ship, and they got their, I don't know if they got paddles, I'm not really an expert at that time, but I'm just going to picture it that way. I'm picturing, you ever see that painting of Washington over the Delaware? That's the disciples. Maybe they're singing a captain song too, like, hey, ho, or I don't know. But they're just like, their face is set like flint. The other boat's looking at them going, whoa, these guys got it. Wow, okay, I feel better. We're on a lake with them, all right. Or, scenario number two, the disciples are on there and they're going, we're all going to die. Ah, it's so bad. The storm is so bad. What are we going to do? Ah! Now, which one do you think is better for the little boats? Right? My first time, I never flew in an airplane, so I started taking groups on missions trips. Nobody tells you about turbulation. The planes just drop for no reason. I swear the pilots must, I mean, why? How does that happen? I remember the first time we're taking off. I'm kind of a little nervous. I'm in the air. I'm holding my wife's hand. Like, okay, we're in the air. This is good. We'll be here for a few hours. And man, the first time, whoa, 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 you know. And it was always when they hand you the immigration forms and the custom forms. You're trying to run, rah, rah, the plane's going like that. And I'm like, this is it. We're done. Planes can't do this. And I would look up at the flight attendants. And if the flight attendants were chilled, then I was okay, you know. They're like, here, would you like some Coke with that here and give you that? And as long as the flight attendants were cool, I was good. But if a flight attendant would have went, we're going down, I'm crawling underneath my, does that make sense? Yeah, I think when things get scary, we look to the big ships. Every one of us, I think we have big ships in our life that we look to. Hey, things are really scary. We go to them. Hey, are you okay? Is everything okay? And Jesus, I believe, and this is really going to be important, because Jesus does rebuke them. He says, you have no faith. I don't think it's because they woke him up. In fact, the Bible says in Philippians 4, it says, be careful for nothing. That means don't be full of care. Don't worry about nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. So I don't believe Jesus, like, I'm trying to take a nap. If they were concerned, I believe they could have said, hey, Jesus, could you calm the sea real quick? It's kind of getting a little rough. The little boats are going. This is just my, I'm thinking this, okay? I think he rebuked them because they came to a conclusion already. Look at verse 38. And while he was in the hinder part of the ship, sleeping on a pillow, they awake him. This is what they say to him. He wake up and they hear this. Master, carest not that we perish. Two things. They assumed he didn't care, and they assumed they were perishing. And that's when Jesus said, why do you have no faith? They came to a conclusion already that they were going to die. Jesus was going to let them die because he doesn't care. That was the conclusion that they came to. Now, listen, this is the point of this. When the little ships are watching us, be careful how you bail the water out of your boat. I mentioned, you know what? In this time, we are not Teflon Christians. Things hit us too. And some of us are taking on water, and some of us are bailing out our boats also. Be careful not to bail out your boat by tossing water into a little boat. I believe when we panic and we go, oh, no, this is the terriblest thing in the world. And lost people are watching us and like, whoa, they walk with God and they're scared too. All we're doing is we're just throwing water. We're bailing out. We're putting it in their boat. We have to be very careful about this. Every one of us, we have little ships watching us, how we're responding to everything right now. This week is so funny. I was just thinking about this week. I was out Friday. I was out for my run. And it's funny. My wife, she tells me the night before, just the last thing she told me before I went to sleep, she says, hey, she says, does our heat use gas? And I said, yeah, the boiler, we just fired it up. Like, the boiler uses gas. She's like, oh, that's not good. I said, what? She goes, consumers just sent us something that says that we're going to be paying like an extra $100 or something else a month. And it's like, oh, jeez, what else? What's next? You know what? So then I let that be in my head for a little bit. I was like the disciples. I'm like, man, I'm taking on water. I'm running. Brother Josh, I know you've probably never done it. This is where I was. I was like, you know what? I'm going to get a second job. Hear me out. McDonald's is paying $16.50 an hour. You'd be going through for your afternoon snack, and you'll see your pastor. You'd like fries with that? $16.50 an hour. And I'm going to tell you, I was thinking that, and the Lord rebuked me in that moment, brought me right back to the scriptures. Brother, why did you already come to the conclusion that you're drowning? Why do you automatically go to that? It brought me right back to this passage of scripture. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Just because as Christians, our ships take on water does not mean he's going to let us sink. Sometimes it just happens that way. And here's the thing, my kids are watching me. Well, I got little boats down there, and they're like, is mom and dad going to, where are they, you know, because they know, we've talked about this. We've told them a little bit, like, why we're not doing certain things anymore, and why we're kind of just living life a little bit differently right now because of things that are going on. They know this. And by the way, my little kids are watching you all, too. They're here every day at church. They know all you, mostly by name. I know there's other little kids downstairs. They're watching us. We are the generation of Oxford Lake Baptist Church that God has put here for this day and this time to weather this storm. They're watching us. The next generation is watching us. We're not going to panic. Your neighbor is watching you. Your boss is watching you. You know, it's funny. I kicked the habit starting last Wednesday of having too much iced tea. I just quit cold turkey. I'm like, I'm not drinking. I go to Speedway. It's one of my things. I said, if I stop drinking Speedway iced tea, I'd give myself a raise of a lot of money, you know? So I just quit. You know, I'm not drinking iced tea no more. I've gone in there. And I just know the same people. And I'm a guy. I'm not a friendly guy. I just go in there and say, hey, thank you. You know, I'm not like, oh, how's your kids today? You know, I'm just not that person. When men shop, we you know, it's a mission. It's a recon mission. As fast as possible, right? I want to talk to his little people. I just look my head down, get my iced tea, get out. And I've been stopped by the, they've seen me so many times, and somehow beyond them, they kind of whisper and rumor, and they say, that's the pastor. I've had them say, hey, can you pray for me? Can you pray for my family? I've had them have storms come up in their life and they know to go and look at the ship that has Jesus with them. I'm just going to tell you, guys, they're watching us. And that's a good thing. But we got to make sure we respond in faith. Let me present you with two scenarios right now. I just mentioned everything going on in the world right now. Does Oxford Lake Baptist Church go, hey,
God's still on the throne. He's sovereign. He's in control. This is all part of his plan for his good and his glory. This is great. Our God is loving. Our God is just. We're fine. God is good. We're going to praise him, and we'll praise him, and we'll praise him. Yeah, a little water comes in the boat. That's okay. We're going to praise him. Or do we put in our sign, the end is near. We're going to drown. This is it. We're going to be nuked. This is terrible. That's not going to look good for us, is it, my friends? We don't go knocking on doors. We go knocking on doors. Hi, we'd like to invite you to our church. We have a great thing going on there. We don't go, listen, you're going to die right now. You know, we don't do that. That doesn't. Some save with fear, the Bible says, but I don't know if they mean like that, you know? Don't flood their boat by bailing out your water on them. Be careful. Be careful. Jesus shows us we got to respond by faith. In verse 40, he says, this is it. You guys have no faith. He said to them, why are you so fearful? See, that's a symptom of no faith. When we have no faith, we're fearful. We can have faith or we can have fear. We can't have both. And we got to respond in faith. Here's the thing. God is in control. If you know God's in control, you're not going to panic. If you know God has you, you're not going to panic. David, who's been through everything in the whole universe, he's fought giants and the kingdom rose up against. I mean, David has been through it, okay? He's fought bears. He's fought lions. David is everything I wish I could be sometimes. You know what he said? He goes, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. He says, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. The rod was able to, you know, those bears and stuff come, they beat you off the sheep, you know, and they poke them away or whatever. And the staff was there for to kind of guide you from falling off a cliff. God's there to protect us and guide us. We know he's with us, for thou art with me. Therefore, take on water. They're watching us. And we say, you know what? Yeah, it is what it is today, but our God is still in control. We trust him. Can I tell you, the little ships, number three, are not just watching. They're following in our wake. They're following in our wake. Again, they're with him. I believe wherever they're going together in that storm. They're following in your wake, the little ships. They're not just watching. Verse 36, they're with him. I saw a really interesting thing in the news. It was kind of a funny little clip. And I'm a runner. I love to run trails, so I thought this was hilarious. This runner was just running through a countryside, and there happened to be a flock of sheep. Anybody else see this? And there was like hundreds of sheep. Nobody else saw it? Good. I can mess up the story and embellish it. Great. No, this is actually true. This girl, she's a runner, and she, you know, we all sheep are dumb, right? So sheep they just like, hey, someone's running, let's go follow them, you know? And this girl's running, and this hiker's coming the other direction. He's the one's filming this. And this hiker and this runner, she's like distraught. She's like, I don't know what to do. There's just hundreds of sheep, they're just following me. I don't know what to do. And they're just, and they're all just following over and over. I just thought that was hilarious. And probably there's a shepherd somewhere going, where my sheep go? Because sheep are dumb. Sheep just follow whatever's moving in front of them. Okay, that's what I want to say. I believe there's little boats here. And by the way, they're trying to blend in. They're probably like, there's little boats here today. And they're like, man, okay, let's see. This is what Christians do. They sing the song. Okay, they're going to sing the song. Okay, this is what we're going to do. Little kids downstairs are doing the same thing, you know. And they're watching those who have Jesus in their boat. But what are they learning? What are they learning? Everything about you says something about you. Everything about you says something about you. Don't sink the little boats in your wake as they follow. When I go my kayak across for my birthday hike and kayak, I always go across Kent Lakes, 3 miles. And as long as a boat is going the same direction in front of me, I get caught in its wake and it actually kind of pulls me along. It's awesome. But they never do that. They always go across, and they always kind of, and I'm in a kayak. They're in these big boats, and they start breaking over my ship, and they start pulling my boat. Like I get knocked off course. I'm trying to go. And I want to say, sometimes we have to be careful that we are not that influence for the little boats. We want to make sure if they get caught in our wake, we're not knocking them off following Jesus. We got to make sure we're not that trail runner that just happened to come through. You know, and you can say this, well, Pastor, they shouldn't be looking at me. They should be looking up Jesus. They should be following Jesus. Yes, they should be, and so should you. So if they're looking at you, they should see Jesus. If you're going the same direction, if that lady running was going the same direction as a shepherd, hey, all's good. It should work out that way. But they are watching us, and our children will do not what we tell them to do, but they'll watch and they'll do what we actually do. That's what our children do. That runner didn't even try to get those sheep to follow, because why? The little ships will follow anything that moves. They come here and they look to you. What are you saying to them? Long time ago, not beating anybody up, long time ago, we actually had a really sad Sunday night, way before Brother Josh was here. Remember, we had one Sunday night, the ushers came up to me, they were kind of heads down, they're like, Pastor, we got a problem. there's no one to take the offering up. I said, what do you mean? They said, well, no one's wearing a tie. Now, there's been a rule in this church from 1,000 years ago. I have no idea where it came from. Long before my time, that, you know, if you usher, you got to wear a tie. Listen, everybody hates ties. Nobody here likes ties, okay? It's just life. It's just the way it is. It's the storm that's come, all right? I was the only one, the whole church, wearing a tie that night. I can't usher. I'm the pastor. Maybe I should. I don't know. I don't even know what we did that night. I remember going home. I was kind of upset, you know? I said, man, the flock's not following me. If the men were following me, then they would be dressing. They have a tie on. The ladies were following, they'd be like my wife. They would dress modestly in a dress or a skirt. Or just modest, feminine at least. And I thought, man, they're following another shepherd. I wonder, they got caught in the wrong wake. That's kind of sad. Now listen, we have high standards for those who serve. You may say, man, I've got to wear a tie. You just said you hate tie. We have high standards for those who serve because they're going to have, by nature, they're going to have more little ships watching them. So I want to put real high standards on those with little ships, our Sunday school teachers, our nursery workers, or whatever it may be. I don't know. They might not agree with it, and I'm sorry if they don't, but they're following. And I want to make sure they're leading in the right wake. They're not pulling the wake away from the leadership of the church. I'm going to say the church is growing. This is praise God. I've heard a lot of churches not growing. I'm thankful we are. I'm praising God for it every time. But can I tell you this? If you've been here for a while, please make sure that you're not leading people away in your wake. Yeah, I know the church believes this, but I go this way. I do this. We gotta be careful because people will get caught up in that wake. I believe this instead, and I know the church stands for this. Be careful. God did not put you in that situation. You gotta be real careful there. I believe attitude's important. People will follow our attitude. We got in church. We get here comically early in the morning. It's so weird. And it was funny, the few of us that were here, it just nothing was going right. We couldn't get the copy or the work to print something. And then I keep getting these letters returned in the mail. Somebody typed up a manifesto to send it to every Baptist church in the universe and send it from our address here, which makes us look like nutcases. And I just go, who is this? And I had more of them come in, and we had that going on. And then Levi, my son, walks up and goes, guys, Lydia has a stinky diaper and needs to be. And we're like, oh. I swear the devil tries to get us in a bad mood. So everybody else comes in. How are you doing? Terrible. Everybody else gets in a bad mood because attitude happens, right? Be careful about your attitude. People get caught up in that wake. I believe attitude towards leadership is important. I'm not trying to pad my own nest, but let me just say this here. I can be way more effective as a pastor in people's lives who respect me than those who don't respect me, didn't come to me, didn't ask for help. You know what I mean? And sometimes when I was a youth pastor, I could always tell how I was talked about in homes by how their kids talked to me or how they looked at me or, you know, how they were disrespectful. I'm like, okay, well, I know I'm not very highly respected in that home very much. And frankly, for those kids, I couldn't do much either, which was sad. Church attendance is important. We need to show the little ships what an authentic Christian walk is like. They're going to get caught in our wake. Make sure we're following Jesus. Churches split and die essentially because they start following the wrong wake. They go the wrong way. And one thing we can do is to make sure is what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 1. He says, be followers of me even as I am of Christ. We got to make sure every one of us here that we are caught in the wake of Christ first and foremost. We're following him and him only. Our eyes are on him like Peter in the storm until he took them off. And we're going to follow him. And therefore, those little ships that we're discipling, those little ships that are watching us, they're going to see us, and as they follow us, well, they don't know it or not, they're following Christ. That's how my goal of getting my children saved was. When they're born, they're not saved. They haven't made that decision yet. But I want them to see Dad follow Christ, and as they're following with me, I want them to have their own relationship with Christ when they eventually get to where God allows them to. But there's a wake to follow. My friends, these little ships are weathering the storm without Jesus. They're watching the ship with Jesus. They're following in the wake of those who have Jesus. Lastly, I'd like to put this out. The little ships are wonderfully blessed by the boat with Jesus. When Jesus said, peace be still, can you imagine? I would love to see this. The waves, the waves are breaking up over a boat, right? And all of a sudden he says, peace be still. I don't think nature can behave like our children do sometimes. We say take out the trash, and they think that means sometime before, you know, next Tuesday. I believe nature obeys Jesus because he is the creator of all nature in a moment. Peace be still. Can you imagine the waves? There's one getting ready to break over the boat. Whoa, it's like, peace be still. Psh, sea is glass. I mean, how still would it be when Jesus says, be still? Psh. Can you imagine being in one of those little boats? I mean, if the big boat thought it was going down with Jesus in it, can you imagine those little boats? There's probably some where, I mean, they're just like, all right, guys, this is it. Been a pleasure being on the boat with you. We're going. And all of a sudden, whoa, we're saved. All because they happened to be following a boat that had Jesus in it, and those people got in that boat, and they woke him up. Now, what are we talking about there? I believe our community is full of little ships that are blessed by Jesus in this boat here, known as Ox Lake Baptist Church. In fact, turn your Bibles over to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. I'm hoping I'm not pulling this too much out of context here, but let me just say this. In Matthew chapter 5, in verse 43, I think we need to live our life in such a way the little ships around us are blessed. We're praying for this community. We pray for it every Sunday. I hope you don't think it's just an add-on to service when we say, pray for the president and the national leaders. That is the most controversial thing. I've gotten more flack from saying, I've said that for, boy, how long since I've been here? Almost 20 years in this church. I would say, pray for the president and national leaders. And I will have, it's so funny, especially depending on who's in office. I'm not praying for him. I don't know what to tell you. God says, pray for your leaders. I'm going to pray for them. That's what they says. But people get upset about that sometimes. We pray for our community. We pray for our township supervisor, our policemen, our firemen, our EMTs. We brought our policemen into here. They'll be in here with us next week also as we just adopt a copy praying for them. As they're watching our community, they're doing a great job. They're punishing evil, rewarding good. I think that's awesome. We want to pray for them. I love law enforcement. I love serving alongside them. I love being with them. It's a great thing. We're praying for them. You know, God answers prayers. I believe the community is a better place because we pray for it. Matthew chapter 5, look at verse 43. Matthew chapter 45 to 43 says, you've heard it said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sendeth rain for the just and the unjust. For if ye would love them which love you, what reward have ye? Even the publicans do the same. And if ye salute your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans do so? Be therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. Pray for the little ships in your life. They should be blessed. They're in your life, and you're praying for them. Your doctor, the nurse that you're, if you're at the doctor's a lot, maybe you know them a little bit more. They may be lost. They may be something. Just pray for them. Serve the little ships in your life. God blesses us. Why not bless somebody else? Maybe your neighbor's taking on a lot more water than you, and you can help them out. I think they should be blessed to be living next to you. I'd like to think our neighbors around here are blessed to be living next to us, but I don't know if they feel that way after Wednesday nights when we play out in the yard a little long and we're loud, but I hope so. Of course, what happens when the church is taken out of the world? What happens? Then it gets really bad. The world's blessed by having the church. They don't know it, but the world's blessed by having the church here in the world. Because once we're taken out, it ain't good. I've been teaching my boys to serve the community. It's really important to me that we serve. I think everybody should be serving the church and serve their community. I think everybody should. We actually had in White Lake, we have a community emergency response team called CERT, and I was one of the first classes to be able to do this, and it's really fun. We've got to do some really interesting things when tornadoes have come, and I felt like I like feeling like I made a difference in my community. It's a fun thing. So we had a second class to graduate, but they had to do a test, and their test was kind of a simulation of an emergency, and so they had to get actors to go, oh, I'm hurt, and they'd have to bandage you up and carry you off. So I brought my sons with me, 8-year-old twins, Lincoln and Levi. I brought them with me Monday night. And for, I think, 6 or 7 times, they had to be bandaged up and then unbandaged. And, you know, a lot of people didn't really know what they were doing, you know. And one time, Levi saw them. They took off his shoes, and they were checking his toes. I don't know what that was all about. And he was like, Dad, that was, I said, oh, for your mother's sake, I hope your feet were clean, you know. He'd go, oh, I have a collarbone injury. I don't know what little 8-boy would be. Son, what's wrong? I have a collarbone injury. And Levi would say, oh, my knee. And every time they would try to straighten out their, they go, oh, and they loved it because they would groan. And everybody's like, your kids are really good fakers. I'm like, yeah, I know. You know, they are, you know. And then they're like, wow, they're really good. And on the way back, I said, boys, I'm going to get you guys a big slushie. I said, I'm so proud of you. You guys contributed to society. I mean, they had to do that to get, I mean, that was a big deal to me. I want to be out in the community. I want the community to be blessed. That's why we've brought them into our church every step we can. We bring them in because we want to be a blessing to them. If we make no difference in our community, we have no business being here. So we have to be looking to those little ships. Jesus loves the little ships, and we have to be looking to them. Every one of us have little ships in our life. And remember, they're weathering the same storm, but they don't have the solid rock that we have. They're watching us. You may say, Pastor, there's nobody watching me. I bet you there is. And even if there is one person, even if that one person is a child, still, what the privilege, you have one person watching you. Don't panic. Don't get upset. Don't be losing your cool over whatever's going on. Show them, calm, stay the course. And the only way we're going to do that is by faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We got to have that solid faith, and this is a time where our community can see our faith. They're not just watching, they're following in your wake. The question is, then, who are you following? Don't follow a theologian. Don't follow a televangelist. They're not going to visit you in the hospital, okay? Follow what God has. God has you here at this church. God has you here for such a time as this. And of course, God has revealed himself to us in the word of God. Follow him. Therefore, your kids, whoever gets caught in your wake, will be a blessing to them that just pushes them closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. This is serious. This is a chance to show people how good it is to know Jesus. When I got witnessing and I talked to people, a lot of times they don't go to church anymore because there was somebody in the church that offended them. I don't know if they just got bailed out on, they got caught in the wrong wake, and they won't go back. I don't want to be that one person that turns someone away from the greatest blessing of being a part of a church and to know how good it is to know Jesus Christ. As they follow you, lead them to Jesus. Let's bow in our prayer. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I just have some simple questions I'd like to ask. So remember in closing prayer. And can you say this to me? You can indicate it by slipping your hand up. Nobody, it's just between you and God. Nobody's going to come embarrass you. But can you say that Jesus is in my boat and I know it? I've trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior. I know I'm saved. You can put your hand up, put it right back down. I know I'm saved. I believe I saw most hands come up. But there was a hand that didn't, and I missed it. I'm going to tell you something. You need a bigger faith. You need faith in something bigger than the storms that are here and are coming. If you've never trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you feel today that God would have you to be saved today, we're not asking you to join a church. We're not asking you to be embarrassed. We're not asking you to be baptized. We're asking you to put your faith and trust in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ and be reconciled to God. You know that heaven's your home and be forgiven of sins. All you're going to have to do in just a moment is when we have our prayer of hymn of invitation, Pastor Josh will be standing here right in front of the pulpit. You can go right to him and say, I'd like to be saved today. You won't be the first. You won't be the last. And we'll hand you to a soul winner where they can show you from the word of God how you can be saved today. It's a wonderful truth to know that you're saved and Jesus is in your boat. But let me ask you one more question. Is there anyone here today who say, Pastor, pray for me as my little ships watch and follow me? Pastor, there's little ships in my life and the Lord has brought them to my attention. And the Lord, I need help as they're watching me and following me, and this is my hand. Would you pray for me? Pray for me. I see hands up all over the auditorium. Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come into your presence, Lord, we just thank you for who you are. We thank you for the story of the little ships. Lord, thank you for the little ships in our life. Lord, it's a big responsibility as they watch us, as they follow us. Lord, I just pray that we would be a blessing to them. So, Lord, I pray today that you'd strengthen these who have raised their hands.